Bob Timmons didn't set out to become a track and field coaching icon, but his training methods became so widely noticed and his championship results reached such legendary dimensions that he is recognized as a true pioneer in the sport. Known as Timmy to his admirers, Bob Timmons was short in stature, just over 5 feet tall, but big on ambition. Case in point, despite his size, as a prep, he insisted on running the high hurdles. Then when World War II began, he tried to join the Marines, but was rejected for being too short. He went so far as to hang from a pull-up bar several times a day for months in a vain attempt to increase his height. While that didn't work, his persistence did, and the Marines finally took him. In the closing months of the war in the Pacific, he and his unit saw plenty of action on the front lines. The experience served to strengthen his belief that sheer force of will could influence desired outcomes. In the early 1960s, Timmons took a job in his native Kansas, coaching multiple sports at Wichita East High School. He combined all the demanding qualities of training for various sports and developed his own brand of workouts. In his mind, the key to success was total commitment. It was at Wichita East where his principles were put to the test. First, with a swim team, where he tutored eventual Olympians Jeff Ferrell and Richard Quick. Then in 1963, with a lanky running phenom by the name of Jim Ryan, who willingly endured the regimen put forth by his coach. It consisted of high speed and ultra-high mileage. Lesser athletes would have quit, but Ryan put his faith in Timmons and became the first prep to break the 4-minute mile barrier. Timmons' methods took an athlete to the brink of exhaustion. Push beyond that point, he would say, and you will exceed your wildest expectations. He once asked the Wichita cross country squad to run the state finals barefoot in the snow. They did, and they won. At the high school level, Timmons won 17 state titles in swimming, cross country, and track. In 1964, Kansas University hired him as an assistant to legendary track and field coach Bill Easton. When Easton's retirement was imminent, Kansas officials made sure Timmons had a reason to stay. He had tough acts to follow. Easton, and before that, Bill Hargis, were universally beloved by the Kansas faithful. Once Timmons was in charge, let's just say that warm and fuzzy wasn't on his agenda. A now infamous training session at the start of his tenure began with a leisurely 26.2-mile car drive. He discharged his cross-country team in the middle of nowhere and told them to run home, then drove off. While Timmons fostered a bevy of championships, his grueling approach attracted a great deal of controversy. For every Jim Ryan, there were other athletes who couldn't, and some who flat out would not, endure his extreme coaching style. Over time, though, Timmons produced 16 world record holders, 77 NCAA All-Americans, and 24 NCAA individual champions. Notable athletes who flourished under Timmons include Cliff Wiley, Mike Spielman, and Nolan Cromwell. During his 22-year reign, his teams captured 13 Big Eight indoor titles and 14 outdoor championships. He also led the Jayhawks to the NCAA Indoor National Championships in 1966, 69, and 70. His 1970 squad tied for the outdoor title with Oregon, BYU, and Drake to give him 4 championships in 5 years. In 1997, Timmons was named the prestigious U.S. Track and Field and Cross Country Coaches Association Hall of Fame. Some argue, however, that his greatest contribution was in real estate. He deeded a large plot of land called Rim Rock Farm, the home course of the Kansas cross country team since 1980, to the KU Endowment in 2004. Bob Timmons was called a taskmaster by some, a miracle worker by others. The vast majority of his athletes appreciated how well he prepared them for postgraduate life. His favorite motto has always been, "Do your best, keep your goals high, and shoot for the stars." If you want to find truth in those words, just take a look at the Kansas University trophy case. In the long history of American marathon running, few competitors have excelled so consistently as Clarence DeMar. He always expected to win, especially on his home turf of Boston, and regarded second or third place with utter disdain. Once he was asked the secret to his racing success, he replied, "Run like hell and get the agony over with." DeMar was 22 when he first towed the line in Hopkinton. The last time he ran the 26 miles, 385 yards to Boston was when he was 65. Clarence Harrison DeMar was born in Madera, Ohio, June 7th, 1888. It was a harsh early life. His troubled family lived a hand-to-mouth existence. Living with relatives through much of his childhood, the deprivation and loneliness fostered stern independence. Yet he yearned for a stable family life. His release was running, first to and from school, and then as he matured, the round trip from his job at a print shop. The meager wages he earned helped support his mother and five younger siblings. The constant running created a deep base that would serve him well for many years. In 1909, DeMar enrolled at Harvard. He learned of a local long-distance race held every April that was gaining fame for its robust course. It was called the Boston Marathon. Full of confidence, he challenged himself to master the distance. His first attempt was valiant. He placed second to winner Fred Cameron in the 1910 Boston Marathon. In 1911, after doctors cautioned him not to run because a routine exam revealed a heart irregularity, DeMar ran anyway and won the race in a new course record of 2:21:39. The heart issue? It was later determined to be the normal, slow, at-rest heartbeat associated with high-mileage runners. After a disappointing 12th-place finish in the 1912 Olympic Marathon, DeMar decided to take a break from competition. By 1917, he decided to resume racing. But the U.S. was now fully involved in World War I. DeMar was drafted into the Army and spent almost 2 years overseas. His return to competition in 1922 produced another win at Boston in a new course record of 2:18:10. He didn't let up, winning in 1923 and again in 1924. Later that summer, he ran well enough in the Paris Olympic Games to earn the marathon bronze medal. During one 11-month stretch starting in 1926, he won five marathons across the Northeast, including the 1927 Boston race. Few have ever matched his ability to quickly recover. On St. Patrick's Day, 1928, DeMar won a 44-mile race from Providence to Boston in just over 5 hours and 41 minutes. A mere month later, he took Boston for a sixth time. DeMar notched his record 7th Boston victory in 1930.
Here they come, 184 of them. It's the start of the Boston Marathon. Here he is. Doesn't even look as if he's warmed up yet. And now the finish. Brother Legionnaires from the Melrose Post drape the flags over him. Governor Allen hands him a medal, and he sure earned it.
No one has won more times, and certainly nobody has come close to winning it at the ripe old age of 42. The previous year, DeMar married and took a job teaching industrial arts at New Hampshire's Keene State College. He enjoyed the family life the rest of his days. When he decided to earn a master's degree at Boston University in 1932, true to form, DeMar ran and walked the 90-mile round trip from Keene to Boston each week. In all, the man they called Mr. DeMarathon raced in 33 Boston marathons, was named to 3 Olympic teams, and won the AAU marathon twice. He ran his last Boston marathon in 1954 at the age of 65. Just a few days before he died in 1958, it is said that Clarence DeMar crawled from his sick bed and into the backyard. There he meticulously planted a garden. Loved ones said it was proof of his desire to always go the extra mile. What should we make of the perseverance and intense mileage throughout his lifetime? Perhaps he never forgot his fractured childhood. And all along, Clarence DeMar was simply just running home. There are those who would say Vince Matthews was a man for his time. He competed during an era that was politically and socially turbulent. The Olympics in which he found his greatest fame was rife with tragedy, and for Matthews became a major tipping point in his own life. Yet through it all, Vince Matthews emerged as not only an athletic force, but a man who used his physical ability to speak volumes for the issues affecting human rights. Vincent Edward Matthews was born in Queens, New York, during the first post-World War baby boom. His would be a vocal generation. As he matured, he developed into a dominant U.S. long sprinter, joining the likes of Hall of Famers Lee Evans and Larry James. From their teens, Matthews and Evans had forged an ardent on-track rivalry. Off, they shared a deep and lasting mutual respect. Unlike his rivals, he attended a small Eastern school, North Carolina's Johnson C. Smith University. However, by 1967, he was regarded as a force in the U.S. long sprint corps. That year, he clocked a 45 flat for 400 meters, a mere tenth of a second off the world record. Then at the 1967 Pan American Games, he earned a silver medal in the 400 and a gold medal as a member of the U.S. 4x400 meter relay team. In the meantime, on the college campuses and streets across the country, the social and political status quo was being questioned. Matthews noticed, and while he was proud to represent his country, he felt conflicted over the opportunities afforded to some and not to others. The 1968 season started oddly. Matthews set a 400-meter world record of 44.4, but the mark wasn't ratified because he wore unapproved running spikes. In June, at the U.S. trials, he was beaten out of the top three in the 400 by Evans, James, and Ron Freeman. This would pale in comparison to bigger events to come. Mexico City, October 1968. Matthews runs the first leg on the U.S. gold medal-winning 4x400-meter relay team. They set the world record of 2:56.16. the mark lasts for 24 years. On the medal stand, Matthews and his teammates raise their fists in solidarity with teammates Tommy Smith and John Carlos. This Olympics becomes a watershed moment in social activism. At the 1972 U.S. Olympic trials, Matthews finished third in the 400, behind John Smith and Wayne Collette, but ahead of his old rival Lee Evans. He made the 400-meter squad, but he also noticed that not much had changed from 1968 to 1972. The palpable social tension that permeated the nation still existed. Matthews the athlete and Matthews the socially conscious citizen of the world were on a collision course that would intersect at the Munich Olympic Games. All three Americans make the 400-meter Olympic final. Smith, on the outside, takes the early lead, but soon drops out with a pulled hamstring. Matthews, in lane two, unaware of Smith's misfortune, concentrates on his pace and form. Gazing down, his lane slips under his stride, like track beneath a locomotive. Around the final turn, he resists the pain and tells himself to breathe. Hold form, push harder. He senses the finish line and tries to raise his arms in victory, but they're too heavy with fatigue. It's Matthews in 44.66, Collette second in 44.8. On the medal stand, as the flag ascends, Matthews is awash in pride, but mindful that back home, the unfulfilled promises for tens of thousands still exists and the country he loves. It is a revelation. He turns to Collette. They understand what they must do. They will be indifferent. The two Americans are scorned by some, applauded by others. Meet officials immediately banish Matthews and Collette from the games. With their exit and Smith's injury, the Americans cannot field a 4x400-meter relay team. The hopes for a gold medal for the U.S. and Matthews in the long relay are dashed. The IOC eventually sanctions the pair from any future Olympic participation. Matthews later admitted how significant the victory was to him. 20 years from now, he said, I can look at this medal and say, I was the best quarter-miler in the world that day. And if you don't think that's important, you don't know what's inside an athlete's soul. Vince Matthews was a man of his time. And as the passage of years can attest, he arrived at just the right time. Distance runner Craig Virgin is a conundrum. In one breath, you can describe him as first, and in another, last. An odd tag to place on someone with such a deep running resume, but an apt phrase as one takes stock of his illustrious career. Born on August 2, 1955, Craig Virgin grew up on the family farm in Lebanon, Illinois. As a kid, his favorite pastime wasn't running.
When I was growing up, I didn't want to be a track star. I wanted to be a St. Louis Cardinals second baseman.
At first, a sport of any kind was nearly out of the question. As a toddler, he was diagnosed with a congenital urological disease. Surgery at age 5 failed to fix the problem. Antibiotics kept him alive for the next 8 years. And then at 13, he underwent life-saving reconstructive surgery. Just a few short months later, he began a running career that would span 23 years. His disorder was not fully resolved until 1994, when his right kidney was removed, 2 years after he retired. Once Virgin did start racing competitively, he never looked back on his youthful baseball aspirations. Instead, he blossomed into a veritable triple threat. equally capable on the track, in road racing, and on the cross-country course. Yet, he had a preference.
By far, my favorite was cross-country, I think, because I was a farm boy, and I grew up herding cattle in the pasture. So I grew up running on grass, on hills, and to me, that was just natural. It was the all-natural environment, and it fit me to a T.
In high school, Virgin set 12 age group world and national records. His two-mile time as a sophomore in 1972 is still the national record for 15-year-olds. In 1973, he broke Steve Prefontaine's national high school two-mile record, running the distance in 8:40.9. Between his high school sophomore season and his senior year in college, he won 95 of 100 races in cross country. While at the University of Illinois, Virgin won 9 Big Ten Conference championships and 31 of 35 cross country races, including the 1975 NCAA cross country title. In an era when older, seasoned foreign athletes were allowed to dominate the collegiate running landscape, Virgin was the top American in 8 NCAA national competitions. In 1979, on the track, Virgin broke Prefontaine's American 10,000-meter record with a 27:39.4 effort. The following year, he ran over 10 seconds faster in what, at the time, was the second quickest 10,000 in history. He's best remembered, however, for his cross-country performances in lands far from home. Paris, the Longchamps race course, Sunday, March 9th, 1980. The World Cross Country Championships. The pre-race favorite is Great Britain's Nick Rose. Rose appears destined for victory, but falters in the final stretch. What occurs next makes U.S. cross-country history.
This could be the closest title, and Virgin is burning up and going past Nick Rose and closing on Ortman with 100 meters to go. Ortman has been overtaken on the inside. Craig Virgin of America goes into the lead and won't be overtaken. It's a unique American victory, I'm sure. Nick Rose in third. And it's America 1, West Germany 2.
The following year at Madrid, Spain, Virgin again rose to the occasion. The race came down to the American and Ethiopia's Mohamed Kadir. They battled, sometimes shoulder to shoulder, over the last 600 meters.
I put the hammer down with 200 to go, flew by him, and this time it was a little easier. I had the lead with 100 meters to go and crossed the finish line for my second World Cross Country Championships.
For Virgin, the win validated the previous season's victory. After 3 decades, the consecutive titles are an inspiration to anyone who follows U.S. distance running.
And we finally struck a blow for American distance running in the world hierarchy and said that American distance runners can run with the best in the world.
Some of Craig Virgin's American records were only recently surpassed, including the U.S. National Track and Field Championship's 10,000-meter meet record, which he held for 25 years, and the U.S. Olympic Trials 10,000 record, his for 24 years. And he's still the only American 10,000 runner to qualify for 3 Olympic teams. His most enduring legacy is being the first American to win the World Cross Country crown and the last U.S. runner to do so. First and last, a conundrum indeed, but one certainly worthy of praise.
Whether I achieved the most that I had in me, the greatest potential, I'll never know. Maybe I could have done things a little bit differently. Looking back now, I think I accomplished more than most and less than a very few, and I guess I can live with that.
There's an old saying that when one can assert their ability with utmost confidence, it goes, no brag, just fact. Maurice Greene could often make that claim without reproach during his career. power, raw speed, determination, showmanship. Maurice Greene had all the key ingredients to be the quintessential American sprinter. That he could be a showman, there was very little doubt. Once, after a 100-meter victory, Greene removed his shoes as if they were on fire. A teammate rushed onto the track with an extinguisher to put out the supposed flaming shoes. But throughout his career, he could never be accused of false bravado. Maurice Greene was fast. He knew it, and so did everyone else. Once in race mode, his level of concentration rose to a singular level. As far as he was concerned, the competition was secondary to defeating the distance, outrunning the clock, and taking what was rightfully his, the finish line. Maurice Greene excelled in both football and track at Kansas City's F.L. Schlegel High School. Upon graduation, Nike was so impressed by his potential that they signed him to a contract. He was young and his talent was raw, but he was determined. 1997 would be his breakout season. At that year's USA Championships in Indianapolis, he put the world on notice when he blazed through the 100 meters in 9.9 seconds. Later that summer at the World Championships in Athens, Greece, Greene captured the 100-meter title. He successfully defended his World Championship title in 1999 and then again in 2001. At the 1999 World Championships in Seville, Spain, he was the first man to win both short sprint events. Also in 1999, he set a then 100-meter world record at 9.79, surpassing Canadian Donovan Bailey's world record of 9.84. Since the advent of electronic timing, the 100-meter world record had never been lowered by such a large margin. Next for Greene, the goal of any ambitious world-class sprinter, to win an Olympic gold medal. Sydney, Australia, the 2000 Olympic Games. As anticipated, Greene makes it through the early rounds and into the 100-meter final. At the gun, the field is nearly even out of the blocks. But then Greene seems to find a gear that he alone possesses. He pulls away. The race and Olympic gold is his. On the medal stand, he is officially anointed world's fastest man. It is a moment he savors. Hand in hand with that title, though, is running anchor on the 4x100 relay team. Greene receives the baton from Brian Lewis. His anchor leg is not only superb, it is a jaw-dropping example of the sprinter's power and competitive focus. In 2004, Greene returns to the Olympic Games and in Athens earned a bronze medal in the 100 meters. Later, in the 4x100 meter relay, Greene was again entrusted with the anchor leg. By the time he received the baton, the U.S. team was in third place. He nearly caught Britain's Mark Lewis Francis at the finish line. The United States missed the gold medal by just 1/100th of a second. His anchor leg was both valiant and nearly superhuman. Over the course of his career, Maurice Greene ran 53 sub-10-second 100-meter races, at one time more than any other sprinter in history. In 1999 alone, he ran 9 sub-10s for the distance. To this day, his 60-meter indoor record continues unchallenged at 6.39. And he is the only elite sprinter to hold both the 60-meter indoor and 100-meter outdoor world records at the same time. In looking back over his years in the sport, Maurice Greene had the distinction of not only being one of the most universally feared sprinters the world had ever seen, but being one of the most respected as well. To say that Gail Devers had one of the greatest comebacks in track and field history could be the understatement of this or any century. An 8-time world champion and 3-time Olympic gold medalist, Devers overcame more than a few obstacles on her way to becoming one of the best sprinter hurdlers of all time. Born Yolanda Gail Devers in November of 1966, she was quiet and introspective in her youth. But early on, she had something to prove.
I was little. You know, when you're little and you're in grade school and they're picking like teams, they don't pick the little ones because they don't think you can do anything. So you have to show, like, I'm fast, I can do this. And I think that just carried over into everything that I did in life.
As a kid, when she raced against the neighborhood boys, she routinely won. At San Diego's Sweetwater High School, whether she was sprinting 100 meters flat or over low hurdles, she invariably won. In 1984, she took that unrelenting speed all the way to the California State meet her senior year. There, she impressively triumphed in both events. Pursued by a bevy of colleges, she chose UCLA, where her raw talent continued to evolve. And again, she quite often won. Devers was a perennial Pac-10 champion in her chosen events. And in her senior year, she was named the Pac-10 Athlete of the Year. This after winning the 1988 NCAA 100-meter dash in a wind-aided 10.86 and setting an American record in the 100-meter hurdles. Then, without warning, while training for the 1988 Summer Olympics, she began suffering from migraines and vision loss. Although she qualified for the 100-meter hurdles, she was eliminated in the semifinals at Seoul. Her health continued to decline. Her weight dramatically dropped. She was constantly fatigued, and she lost nearly all of her hair. Gail Devers, the winner, was facing a losing battle against an unseen foe. And doctor after doctor could not tell her why.
Now nobody can explain to me what's going on, why it's going on. Will I ever run again?
What the doctors failed to recognize were the signs of severe Graves' disease, a debilitating and life-threatening thyroid condition.
The biggest relief to me was the day that I was diagnosed. It was scary, but it was a relief that finally, I'm not crazy. Finally, there is something wrong with me. It's not curable, but it is treatable.
Correctly diagnosed, she underwent a battery of treatments. Soon, she regained her health. And 2 years from when her symptoms first appeared, and with the help of her coach, Bobby Kersey, she started looking like the Gail of old. A second place in the 100-meter hurdles at the 1991 World Championships in Tokyo confirmed she was climbing back. Next for Devers, Olympics redemption at the 1992 Games in Barcelona. She would qualify in both her specialties, and in both, she would be favored. At the 1992 Games, there would be no Olympic low hurdles championship for Gail Devers. In the final, clearly in the lead, she smashed into the 10th hurdle and stumbled across the finish line out of the medals. She vowed to make the 100 meters quite a different story.
Fair start in the women's 100. Cuthbert away quickly, so's Gail Devers. Here comes Provalova and Adi. Gail Devers has the lead. Cuthbert is there. Provalova, it's a tight finish. It might have been Gail Devers.
She wins in 10.82. Her celebration with Coach Kersey is nearly as electrifying as the race. She then began a string of outstanding World Outdoor Championship performances. 1993, Stuttgart, Germany. Double gold in the 100 meters and the 100 meter hurdles. 1995, Göteborg, Sweden. Devers destroyed the rest of the field in capturing the top spot in the 100 meter hurdles. These accomplishments all led up to another Olympic team, and a chance to tie Hall of Famer Wyomia Tyus's record of two straight Olympic 100-meter titles. Atlanta, July 27, 1996. The 100-meter Olympic final. Devers is again in a competitive race. The finish is at first too close to call, but then she is declared the victor in 10.95 seconds. In grand fashion, she celebrates the repeat victory with Coach Kersey.
Being told that I won and knowing what that actually meant. And it's not just that you won two gold medals, it's that out of the whole history of the Olympic Games, there's only two people who've ever done that in life.
She adds another gold medal as part of the victorious U.S. 4x100 meter relay team. After Atlanta, Devers scored another run of impressive outdoor world championships performances. 1999, Seville, Spain, low hurdles gold. 2001, Edmonton, Alberta, low hurdles silver. Then at the U.S. Olympic trials in 2000, she set the still standing American low hurdle record of 12.33. At the Sydney Games, however, nagging injuries forced her out of the event in the semifinals. In all, Gail Devers competed on five U.S. Olympic teams, in six outdoor and four indoor world championships, and in the 1987 Pan American Games. Just to put a fine point on her illustrious career, at the 2007 Millrose Games, Gail Devers, at the age of 40, won the 60-meter hurdles in 7.86 seconds, only 12 hundredths of the record she herself set in 2003. Truly, Gail Devers is the greatest female combo sprinter hurdler the sport has ever seen. And despite all the medals and all the glory, and of course, those famous fingernails, she continues to carry herself like the quiet little girl of her youth.
I don't think about titles. I think my kids later on in life will say, oh, that's kind of cool, Mom, okay. For me, I'm just grateful to have been able to participate and do what God has blessed me to do, and any titles that come with that is just a title.